Just checking the general proportions of this little kozuka that's been sent to me. It requires a little bit of tender care, as you can probably see. There's some severe staining here and here. I'll talk about that in a moment. There's a few other details. I'd like to talk about it in its present condition before it receives a bit of care and treatment from myself. It's actually made by Goto Ichijo. Goto Ichijo, along with Kano Natsuo and Harawaki Hogen, are sometimes considered to be the last three great masters of the Tosogu tradition, and the classical tradition, working at the end of the 19th century. Despite the surname Goto, Goto Ichijo wasn't in fact a master of any of the mainline Goto schools. He was something of a maverick in that he broke away fairly early on and worked very much in his own style. This piece actually is more reminiscent of some of the more formal work of Kano Natsuo or even Harawaki Hogen. So they were all very much the kind of artists who were catering to similar clientele and to similar tastes. Anyway, like most kozuka, they fit within a fairly tight framework of measurements. This is 9.5 centimeters long and about 15 millimeters wide. These are pretty standard across the board. Of all the sword fittings, the kozuka is the most uniform. Kozuka, small handle. This is, of course, a little handle. There's a utility blade that fits in this end, and it fits in the scabbard. So this is how the scene is viewed when worn on the sword. It's of shibuichi, and one of the ways we can tell that it's shibuichi, apart from the color, but color can often be misleading, is the surface texture. As I was saying, I know that this is shibuichi because of the structure, the texture of the metal surface. There is a layer of wax that's oxidized. There's various oxides and grime on the surface, but nevertheless, I can see a fine, it's a sort of network structure in the surface of shibuichi. What this is when the alloy is made, the copper doesn't fully amalgamate with the silver or doesn't mix fully. So what you have are tiny particles of copper surrounded by a fine network of silver. And this creates a very soft, mottled appearance that the Japanese connoisseurs call nashiji. Nashi is, of course, the Japanese pear. And if you've seen a Japanese pear, you'll know it has that speckled ground. It's also, incidentally, the name of the aventurine speckled gold Japanese lacquer. That's called nashiji urushi, or kin nashiji, gold nashiji. In this case, of course, it's just this subtle modeling. Another name, perhaps a little older, certainly more poetic, name for shibuichi is rogin. Rogin translates as misty silver, and of course the mottling, the haziness of the shibuichi is quite apt. There's a little scratch, a little mark in the surface. These are the kind of things I have to consider carefully when restoring pieces like this. This is a very delicate piece, so polishing that out would reveal fresh metal, which may patinate to a different tone than the rest of the surface. What's happened over the years is that the copper content of the shibuichi alloy has tarnished in one way, and the silver content has tarnished in another, which is why we get various green and brown, sometimes yellowish tones in the shibuichi, none of which were original to the piece, but are a consequence of age and further tarnishing and so forth. The problem, of course, is that it's not very stable, and there comes a point where it can look quite ugly. That's a little bit of dark staining around the moon, for instance, is quite lovely, and the darkening around the gold haze here, which I'll explain in a moment, that also looks quite lovely. However, this kind of staining is far less attractive when it's in these bands here. And what these are is the result of not this box, but a previous box at some point had little elasticated placeholders across here, covered in crepe silk, no doubt, but the rubber band that was inside it is what's caused this, because rubber, vulcanization of rubber involves sulfur. Traces of sulfur remain, and they've impregnated the fabric and subsequently the surface of the metal. So this black, unfortunately, is a problem. It's not terribly uncommon, sadly, but fortunately I know how to repair it. Getting back to the nashiji texture, another characteristic of shibuichi is that it often has what appears to be a velvety or slightly matte surface finish, not quite like a hard glassy polish. And that is, of course, again, due to the actual structure, the copper and the silver content both responding differently to the patinating solution, such that the copper reacts more than the silver, not at all, in fact. And so some of the copper is consumed. I wouldn't say etched, but just becomes part of the oxide, so that the copper is slightly recessed, ever so slightly. And this is what gives the characteristic velvety appearance. It's very, very hard to film or photograph, but up close, it's like a very, very, very fine orange peel effect. If you imagine a microscopic stone wall, perhaps that's another way of thinking about it. Here in this close-up of the gold inlay, the keshi zogan, you can see a few of the indents weren't quite fully filled, or perhaps the mercury has fallen out, didn't quite adhere. It does struggle sometimes to fully adhere to shibuichi, in my experience, so it's possible that a few little plugs fell out. But therein lies the clue to the technique. Under a microscope, you can see very clearly that these are little conical indents, not actual true inlay holes, which would be flared open at the bottom. So these are little pin punch holes that, as I say, a couple of them haven't been filled properly. What's interesting here is we've got this little brown staining on the gold. Now, what that is most likely is the silver component of the alloy, it being gold and silver, tarnishing, forming a silver sulfide or a silver chloride or a mixture of the pair. That then, with the color of gold, those wavelengths interfering with those oxides, gives us this curious ochre staining. That comes off actually quite readily. This is the other decorative feature on the shibuichi, a tiny nightingale in fine silver. I have to say, this is probably one of the finest little birds I've seen carved in this scale. He measures about 12 millimeters long. It's a touch under half an inch. The highest point here is about 2 millimeters from the ground, and around the outside, there's a sort of height, little wall, for those of you interested in the technicalities, about half a millimeter. It's exquisitely delicately carved. I'm really struck by these little pinnate feathers, how delicately each one is formed. That's such incredible care. And I really love, this is the other wing here. So this shoulder here, there's the corresponding one on the other side. Then you see the tip of the wing on the other side also, and his little feet at the back there. Really exquisitely rendered, and a really lovely sense of perspective with the wings like that. Incredible delicacy, and of course, immaculate inlay work. It wouldn't work really if there's any kind of upset metal around the little bird. This shibuichi background has to be pristine, and the bird really has to appear to just be floating above the surface. Immaculate sort of compositional foil to the moon and the hazy clouds on this shibuichi ground. Really deft, delicate, elegant touch. This is the back of the Ichijo kozuka, and for me, this is perfect. It doesn't look anything like it would have done when it was new, and I explain how this patina, in the full sense of that word, of patina, has come about, and why I would be very loath to change it or interfere with this at all. So the work that I will do, I will try to confine solely to the front to deal with those ugly blemishes. But the back is something that I think any sensitive connoisseur would want to preserve. So what we have is the basic patina, which is a dove grey. It now has a slightly greenish tinge to it. This is, in my opinion, due to the silver chlorides, which are yellowish, that have formed over the years, and that's given the grey tone, a touch of green or yellowishness to it. What has also happened over the years is that silver has then gone further and tarnished with exposure to sulfides in the air, and you've got this severe darkening, the bottom here and at the top. And it's likely that it was everywhere. But with handling and it being touched, that silver, the silver sulfide, the blackness, has been rubbed off. You can still see traces of it around some of the engraving. But it's much lighter. And in some areas where it's been rubbed, perhaps with a cloth, I'm not sure. But they're very definite streaks where the patina is much lighter. So what we've got are layers of oxide staining, tarnish, rubbing. This would be impossible to replicate. It speaks of its age. It's been gently cared for. This is something that's quite revered in Japan. This is an object that has acquired its sabi and its wabi, that mellow patina of age. So the patina in technical terms, just the colour, but also in this case the patina, the tiny marks, the additional tarnish, the grime, the wax, all of that making up this wonderful tonal landscape. So the decoration on the back appears to be a haiku. These three columns here, I think, are the haiku. That's, I think, the character for river, kawa, something, no, possessive, tsukiya, so the moon, something to do with the moon. That looks to be the character for nichi, or day, or sun. It's going to take a little while to figure it out. It may be a famous haiku, it may be the work of an amateur, it could be a poem by Goto Ichijo himself, I don't know. This, as they say, requires more study. But beautifully and loosely, naturalistically, painted on and chiseled. This is Ichijo's signature. That's Ichi, one. So that's easy to recognize. And this last character is a kao. A kao is a sort of a stylized monogram. There are formal rules for designing a kao, and each artist has a distinctive one. You will also see within a family or a school or students of a master, the kao often is similar. There'll be evolutions. So when you look at Goto Ichijo's students, he had five main students, Ichijo's tigers, they were known as. The kao are, there's a familial relationship something I've talked about before, you can see that they have a similar structure, and there'll be minor variations in the flourish, the strokes, and little dots that sometimes form part of the design. But that's his signature and his kao. And here at the butt of the kozuka, we can really see that sulfide tarnish is really black. If that was an isolated area, you'd be forgiven for thinking it was shakudo. It really is quite a beautiful sort of licorice black. But that is sulfide. It's just sulfides combining with the silver in the alloy, and then it gently fades away as it's been rubbed and worn, creating this lovely smoky, shadowy effect, which, as I said earlier, I'm going to try and preserve. Contrasts also beautifully with the gold lining, which is one at the top as well, of course. How these little slivers of gold foil that often form parts of kozuka, either as linings like this, or in fact the entire back side of a kozuka will often be covered with a thin foil, about the thickness of airmail paper, for those of you who can remember what airmail paper looks like. It's unclear at the moment how they actually joined it. I don't believe it was soldered in the sense that we understand today. Neither do I think it was any kind of amalgam, mercury amalgam fusing. It may well be that they were using something like a copper salt solution, a bit like the granulation technique, or might be straightforward direct fusing. These are areas that have yet to be studied, and they're certainly, as far as I've come across, I haven't come across any descriptions of gold fusing techniques, other than one brief mention in something Natsuo wrote, which I've fiddled around with a little bit, but it doesn't fully explain this kind of process. So watch this space.
Hi, I'm Ford. I really love making these films, but I could do with your support. Please consider joining me on my Patreon channel. You'll get early access to the films that I make. There's some content on there that I haven't released. Eventually everything does get released, but you'll get much earlier access. There's also far easier to answer questions and engage in conversation there than here on YouTube. Also, there's a donate button if you feel moved to support these films, or they've been helpful to you, or you've enjoyed them. Similarly, click like, subscribe, and share with your friends, please. Let's get the word out. This is a fairly niche subject. It's precious to me, and I think it is to you. I'd like to keep doing it. Thank you.